presentation. Good afternoon, everyone. Many congratulations to all the winners that have been awarded today. And I'm very, very humbled to actually be standing on this platform, especially after Wing Commander Sabarwalji. I think very inspiring discussions since morning. So thank you very much. Why am I here? I think before we get started, how many of you hire first-time job seekers? So there's still some hope in life, right, for us in India. Yeah, and I think that's what I'm going to talk about, because obviously life is not easy for the first-time job seekers, especially in today's India. All of us have been through that routine. All of us have seen the good part and the bad part. And we're still trying to figure out how do we ensure these kids do a good job at our organizations. And while this comes on, yeah, thank you. So just a quick show of hands so that I can kind of talk accordingly. How many of you hire engineers, first-time graduates from colleges? Great. How many of you hire just graduates, BA, BCom, BSc? How many of you hire non-graduates? I'm happy to see some show of hands there, because I think that's where our youth is coming from now. We don't need people to complete degrees to be able to get the skills that today's India or today's industry needs. So quickly, background on why I'm here, what I have been doing, and why I probably be able to share a few of my experiences with all of you. I work with a company called TeamLease. We believe we are in the people's supply chain. We've given employment in the last 17, 18 years of our existence to over 15 million first-time job seekers, a lot of them undergraduates, right? Having said that, we give employment, or we have been able to get the offer letter out to only 5% of the kids who've actually come to us looking for employment. And that's the problem that I'm sure each one of us face. 95% of these kids are sent back home, not because they don't bring a degree or a certificate or a diploma with them, but purely because they are unemployable. And how do we resolve that problem? The 5% will probably get to 6, 7, 8% because some changes are happening in the education world. But can we make it to a 40%, 50%? Right now, the roadmap is very, very blurry in India. The Indian context, right? I'm sure all of you know that we are adding 12 million workforce every year to a labor force, right? Now, these 12 million can come either with knowledge or with skills. Today, most of them come with only knowledge and very little skills. However, what all of you look for and what all of industries in India look for is 90% skills. But the kids that come to us looking for employment is with 90% knowledge and degree and not skills. When Commander Sabarwalji mentioned, you know, happy to see someone dirtying hands, unfortunately, we find very, very few people, especially engineers, actually who are willing to dirty their hands and learn from the root rather than just theory. I have a degree, and because I have a degree, I have a right to actually get employed. Right? So all of that actually creates a bigger problem for us, HR folks, recruiters, employers, whatever you want to call it, right? You would know some part of this, but let me just reiterate. Where are these first-time job seekers coming from? I don't know about you, but I have hired a lot of first-time job seekers who are the only working member in their families in the formal sector. And they come from farming families. They don't even know that they're supposed to come to work at 9 a.m. every day without fail. Because they've never seen their families do that. Family mein kya hota hai? Subah 4 baje suraj ug gaya, before the suraj, I have to go. I have to do some work on my farmland. I come back, I sleep during the day, probably go back again at 3 or 4, do whatever is needed. And this is true farming time. What do I do when this non-season time, right? So kids are not aware that they are supposed to have a certain level of discipline, certain level of hygiene, basic things. But they are the people who are actually coming to us looking for employment. The next transition is really rural to urban. I'm not going to spend too much time, but we all know the kind of migrations that are happening into the, if not the top 20, but the top 50 cities in India today, right? And that's where the jobs are. Today, we cannot take jobs to people, or we are unable to take jobs to people. So what is happening? We're getting people to jobs. I'm not sure how many of you actually hire delivery boys for food services or delivery boys for e-commerce chain. Where do they come from? They don't come from a Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, maybe even Pune. They actually come from Talegaon. They come from beyond Kolhapur. They actually come from Mehroli, and but not Gurgaon and Delhi, right? And Delhi NCR. We are getting so many people into our cities on a daily basis. I mean, Mumbai obviously is the best example of higher migration, but we cannot avoid it. We are going to get people from rural to urban. The third, informal to formal. We find people working thanks to aggregators like Urban Clap and, you know, a couple of others, where we're getting electricians, plumbers, all working on daily wages coming to us, right? They are working informally. They surely don't get minimum wages. And they're not able to make ends meet. So what do? They end up looking for formal employment, even if it's minimum wages. I'll get my statutory, I'll ensure I get my ESI, CPF, I'm covered. It's a much better life for me and my family than waiting for tomorrow and I don't know what it's going to be, right? The fourth transition is really subsistence self-employment to wage employment. Is it good or bad, right? I mean, I'm not sure if you've read about statistics. What is India's unemployment rate? Anyone? HR folks, come on. 4%. Yes. That's the published data by Government of India. And it's not a lie. It's not a lie, sir, because it's not that people are sitting waiting for some job to happen to them, right? The poor cannot afford to be unemployed, so they end up doing things on their own. Now, even your bahar nukkad ka paanwala is a self-employed guy. Whether he is able to make ends meet and get his, you know, income is a secondary issue. But because he cannot afford to be unemployed forever, he ends up doing something small, right? And he continuously keeps looking for where can I go and do wage employment, right? Definitely does not talk about a great genetic pool of being entrepreneurs. I don't think we were very good, at least till the last decade, in starting our own organizations. But it's just that they cannot afford to sit idle. So whether it's the chai wala, it's the paan wala, it's the guy who's probably coming to your house for cleaning things, it could be anyone. Or today, classic example, right? You've got the Ubers and the Olas of the world in India. How many engineers are actually moonlighting being an Uber driver? Well, I've seen it in the US, so in India, bhi achha hi hoga. But why didn't we do it earlier? Well, too bad. Right? And the last piece is really school to work. I mean, this is self-explanatory. Everywhere people are coming in from schools, colleges, polytechnics, ITIs. Sorry, I didn't do anything. Okay. Right. And the last one, industry. All of us in this room, a lot of people hiring outside the room. I would not say that we are very unreasonable people. I think we're very, very reasonable, very kind, nice people, especially when it comes to fresher hiring, right? We're not very demanding, but what we need is basic skills, basic knowledge, right? I don't know if any one of you are looking for 100% ready-made, come today, get deployed, and start being productive from tomorrow. Does that ever happen in the freshers' world? I don't think it even happens beyond freshers' world, actually. It's a different thing. But for freshers, I don't think we expect them to come ready-made. right? I give you a classic example. I was at a panel discussion in Bangalore. I live in Bangalore actually, so I'll keep giving examples in and around. I've been there for the last 15 years. Prior to that, I was in Mumbai. So I get a mix of both cities, which is a good thing. I was on a panel discussion and the director HR of SAP India were discussing what you want from people, from freshers, from engineers. You know, he said, I don't want them to come and start coding from tomorrow and start being productive and billable from day after. But what I want an engineer to do and come with is basic understanding of math and analytical abilities. Unfortunately, engineers today are not even coming with basic math abilities. And the most unfortunate part is that a lot of engineering colleges, by the way, in tier 2 and tier 3 cities, especially starting from Andhra Pradesh, have eliminated a subject called mathematics from the curriculum in an engineering college. I mean, that's the least we can expect a fresher to come with, right? So, yeah. So, but also let's understand from the supply side on what are the complexities they are coming with. Like I said, we are a large workforce. We'll keep adding more and more and more people into our labor markets. Every year we have 12 million people coming in. Imagine a case, now in a lot of job roles as recruiters, as HR people, we keep saying my selection ratio is 1:3. In some ways it's 1:5. In some cases also 1:10, right? Imagine getting it to 1:100. And I don't know how many IT, you know, industry recruiters are here, but I'll tell you, I've seen lines outside an IBM office in Bangalore, which is very close to my house, on a Saturday morning, which is about 5 kilometers. So about, I think there'll be like more than about 5,000-6,000 kids waiting to get interviewed for probably 20-30 jobs. Right? And that's really where we are getting to. I'm sure all of you would have heard about the 20 UP peon positions where lots of engineers, technical people, correct, probably some IS officer kids also applied, ki sarkari job mil jayega, so chalo, theek hai, life is set. Right? Unfortunately, we are getting to that. And that's where the first time job seekers are struggling. Because their competition is not with 1:3 or 1:5, it's actually with 1:100 maybe, and 1:200. We are also becoming the startup capital of the world very, very, very slowly. So every day, there are new organizations and companies being set up. There are new jobs with new skill sets required almost on a daily basis. So what are we expecting these freshers to come with? New skills. Is there a way for them to acquire these skills? I don't think so, because education is surely not kept pace with, you know, with what the industry is looking for. Correct? Do you have a loose connection there? People are hungry. So think jaldi karo. Sorry, computer, probably the guys are operating it, right? Sorry. It's just the cable actually, I can see the screen. Right, thank you. And last but not the least, the geographical spread. Earlier we used to get people from 20, 30, 50 cities, now we're getting people from I don't know how many cities, right? And across the country, across you know, every state, every district, every pin code, we've got apps that keep showing jobs available, we've got apps that keep showing opportunities. So I'm sure you're getting people from many more regions than what you used to be, whether it's in Mumbai or Delhi or Bangalore. Right? And that's the struggle the supply is also looking at. From the demand side, right? Like I said, like recruiters, HR folks, very nice people. At least I believe so. You guys believe so? All of you are HR folks, non-HR, business guys. Any business person here? Okay. Okay, I'm both actually, so it's okay, I'm on both sides. Right? I don't think, like I said, we expect too much, but the base that we look for is some skills, right? Some adaptability. When you tell a person saying, hey guy, you know, just comb your hair every morning and turn up to work, right? You know, in college I never did it, dude. Big deal. So what, why are you asking me to do it now? Right? Sorry. I mean, this is not the country, the company's, you know, stand. You fall in line or you move out, right? Knowledge, obviously, the base minimum, the degree or the certificate or whatever it may be as per your job role or your defined standards. Absolutely a positive attitude to learn, to settle in, to engage, to grow and be part of the organization. And lastly, personal attributes, right? We surely don't want badly behaved freshers in our organizations, right? Which we still get, but we'll try and avoid as much as possible, right? So what do we do to improve employability of these freshers? And I'm here moving from pure hiring to a little bit of L&D and learning, because it's important as for us, all of us, to keep improvising their skills and help them grow. I've called the model as TICK, could call it whatever you want to call it, but four primary things, right? I don't know how many you can read, I think it's a very small font there. But the first line item that I've put in is train for hire. Typically, all of us end up training once the employee is on board, right? Today there are many options on training before they come on board. So I don't know how many of you have tried that, but we've tried that with a couple of our customers and it works like a song. It's beautiful. You pre-select, you pre-assess, you pre-train, you assess again, and only someone who has successfully completed the training actually gets a final offer letter. And in the training world, this one of such models is called a hire, train, deploy, an HTD, right? Really, really works well for first-time job seekers or entry-level employees. The second one is induction training. Right? I'm sure each one of you spend a lot of time in trying to bring these employees on board, trying to ensure that they kind of become part of one unit, one entity, one SBU, right? Company's vision is their employee's vision. BU's goal is this employee's goal. We keep doing all those directions, right? But how much time are we actually spending on seeing whether an induction training is effective? You guys heard the HR Tech, digital HR session earlier, and there is a lot of technology available today to doing it. Having said that, from where I stand and what I see, I haven't seen a first-time job seeker, somebody who's 22, 23, even 18 in a lot of cases, right, be able to learn using just technology. So we need to actually bring in a lot of these things together to ensure that we do the right induction and the right way of induction. The next one is continuous learning. Once an employee comes on board, and I mean, it's very typical to, I think a lot of us Indians, that we don't believe that we need to keep upgrading ourselves. I completed my degree, my post-graduation, I got an MBA, I got a nice job, I'm getting my salary every month, a bus life is set, right? That's not the end of it. I think it's only the beginning of your corporate life. And we have, as HR people, we as recruiters, as whatever we want to call it, as business heads, have to keep handholding the freshers and the first-time job seekers into ensuring they learn continuously. And the last one, now this one is very, very, very close to my heart because it's very essential, it's critical, and it doesn't exist in India today. A lot of people here, some of them showed hands on, you know, you're hiring undergraduates. Can we give them an upgrade path and help them get degrees on the way? Right? If somebody is just a graduate or an engineer and may want to gather more skill sets, how as organizations are we able to actually develop a roadmap for their learning and not their career? Because career is parallel, but unless you learn, unless you grow, you will not be able to get onto your career roadmap. And it is important because all of us believe L&D is a separate function in an organization and somebody else's job to doing it. Trust me, it is not. It's with each one of us to help our colleagues, our employees, ourselves, keep learning forever. Other thing that I would want to put, you know, spend some time on, a lot of HR activities actually boil down to recruitment, right? How many competent people here? Okay, one hand, two. Okay, how many recruiters? Few. Okay, how many HRBPs? Lots. Excellent. What's the biggest crib your business units have? Salary is not coming on time is not a crib, I'm sure. What's the crib? I don't get people. Attrition, right? How do you retain them? So if we actually work towards retaining our employees, and average life cycle, so we payroll about 150,000 people every month who are on contract with us, but with some other organization, and I'm sure few of you would also be taking our employees like that. Average life cycle of a temporary employee with us is about 5 to 6 months. Average life cycle of an apprentice trainee is about 4 months. Average life cycle of a permanent employee? What's your average life cycle? First time job seekers, L1 levels, L1, L2 levels. 8 months, 10 months, 12 months, less than a year? And then you keep backfilling, right? So the cycle is never ending. Can we make it to zero? Absolutely no. But can we make it better than what we are here? Yes. I'll only stand there. So the first thing is where we are sourcing from. What geographies, correct? What skill sets, what education backgrounds? Now, if you're looking at hiring for people in Mumbai, will you find people in Mumbai or will you get people from Madurai in Tamil Nadu and ask them to start settling down in Mumbai first time, you know, freshers? Obviously no, right? Because then you know that the guy will run away. He'll not be able to survive in a city like Mumbai in the first time. But migration is a reality, by the way. But how much can we be cognizant of the fact and decide how do we source right? Educate. I think this is very, very important. It's very important for us to handhold the employee into the organization. Tell them what the organization expects from them. Ask them what they are expecting from the organization. What's the goal? What's the vision? So it's not just induction. It's about ensuring that they assimilate all of this and move forward, right? And help them learn. It's not about giving e-learning titles to them saying, hey buddy, 1,000 titles, go online, good app, my company has learned. Because that's never going to work. Okay? So we have to motivate, we have to ensure that they continuously keep learning. Induction, like I mentioned in my previous slide, a very, very, very important part to bring them in our fold. Today, technology has advanced so much. I mean, I could be standing here and this event could be broadcasted in about 20,000 places at the same time. Are we using gamification, augmented reality into our learning process, into our induction? Forget learning. Just induction. I'm sure a lot of people, there was Bajaj Alliance person here and I know they hired distributed like in thousands of cities. How do you do induction in a distributed environment? You physically cannot have HR travel to every place and do an induction. So first answer is let me create an e-learning, you know, content and let's just give it off to these guys and ask them to tick, tick, tick. I have signed the form. My job is done, right? But life is not that simple. All they'll do is tick, 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 and that's about it. When there's a problem, they'll come back saying, "Lekin aapne to bola hi nahi tha mujhe." Now you figure out your life. Right? So very, very important to ensure both for induction as well as continuous learning, how much of technology interventions are we using? Like I said, having said that, it's pure technology will not work. We will need, I mean, I call it the hybrid model or a multimodal learning model. where you will need a mix of online, on the job, as well as off. Good. At least somebody was listening to me. Face to face, right? So I'm saying, unless you have a mix of all three types of learning, we will not be able to ensure that we're able to induct and continuously teach our employees. One thing in between, and I put, and I think it was almost, you know, hemmed from the induction, is how we help create a first impression for our employees, especially our first-time job seekers or our freshers. Remember the first jobs we all took and how difficult life was. You walk in and you don't know kya karna hai, right? Nobody is telling you, that's the cafeteria, that's the washroom, this is the boss's cabin, never open this room, ye to daat padne wali hai. Correct? Take your own coffee, take your own photocopies, ensure you do your own thing. Very small things. But if you're not able to help them settle down in a workplace, it's going to, they'll run away. Because nobody is teaching them. Trust me, colleges are surely not teaching them to be job ready, especially in these aspects, right? Cognitive skills never taught. Correct? And which is why the last thing that I mentioned is degree connect. Unless and until your induction, continuous learning, education, and a degree connect are seamlessly integrated and we build a plan for our employees, the first-time job seekers, the freshers, the entry-level employees, whatever you may want to call it, they will go away. And I'm coming from kids who have done engineering, kids who are postgraduates, but also kids who are probably 10th fail, 10th pass, 12th fail. Haven't completed the 12th standard, never seen college. For whatever reason, right? It could be financial, it could be skills, it could be because I didn't have an opportunity to go to school or go to college. All of us are hiring people like that today. But unless and until we handhold them in the right manner, it's going to be very, very, very difficult for us to retain them. Last slide before lunch. Okay. I think this is how the roadmap is. And I'll tell you why I've put the apprentice trainee as a center point is because we actually employ about 50,000 apprentices through TeamLease to other organizations. How does it work? Does it work only for chartered accountants, doctors, nurses? Traditionally, yes. Today, a lot of industries are open to hiring. We call them trainees, you want to call them apprentices, you want to call them whatever. But they basically learn on the job. They earn while they are learning. But what, I don't know, how many of you hire trainees? Trainees. Call them apprentices? Bad word. Oh, it's a taboo, trust me. But if you don't do that, I mean, and I know what, the first thing when we mention apprenticeship, people say, oh, you know what, Germany has 4 lakh apprentices. But look at their system, their industry has absorbed all 4 lakh apprentices. If you're not able to take them on board, right, you go to any mall or any shopping center, especially in the retail, you'll see a tag, this girl wearing a trainee tag, and she's trying to hide it as much as possible because then you think she's substandard. So she will not have my answers, let me go find a manager or a supervisor, right? But today we are struggling to hire, we're struggling to hire the right person. Even if you get somebody who is 70% to your skill requirement, to your JD, why not take them? Pay them a stipend which is equal to minimum wages. Build a roadmap from them. They will be a workforce for future. But we need to prepare them for it, right? I mean, they are not going to obviously be ready and jump in saying, "Achha, mujhe trainee le lo." Wo to nahi hone wala. But if the industry accepts it, the employee surely will accept. So develop a roadmap for them, right? Like I'm saying, we have 50,000 apprentice trainees in hotels, in hospitals, in pharma companies, in auto manufacturing and other manufacturing organizations, zero in IT. I don't think we want to run to IT also just for this, right? There's a whole lot of things happening on technology, innovation, L1, you know, jobs going out by AI, ML, there's a lot of sound around it, right? But there's so many other jobs available. We have to prepare people for our workforce, and I believe this is the roadmap where we can help prepare our workforce for our own future. Else, we keep stranded and we can keep talking about it as a problem statement, but never have solutions to it, right? So that's all from my side, right? Thank you so much.